Apex Express, Asian Pacific Expression.
Community and cultural coverage.
Music and calendar.
New visions and voices.
Coming to you with an Asian Pacific Islander point of view.
It's time to get on board the Apex Express.
Welcome to Apex Express. I'm your host and producer, Preeti Mangla Shekhar. On our monthly South Asia Spotlight, I talk with author Sharanya Manivannan on her collection of short stories, The High Priestess Never Marries, and how this collection celebrates women's desires and sexuality through a critical feminist lens. We also hear from Melissa Hung on an exhibit in San Francisco's Chinatown that explores food, art, and gentrification. Stay tuned. Tonight, we go literary feminist and sit down with poet and author Sharanya Manivannan, talk about her first work of fiction, The High Priestess Never Marries, Stories of Love and Consequence. A collection of poetically crafted short stories, Sharanya's book has been described as, quote, a tour de force of language, desire, and ancestral heartbeats. It was shortlisted for the 2016 Tata Literature Live First Book Award in Fiction and has been widely acclaimed by writers and critics. Sharanya has also published a picture book for children. Her first book of poems was titled Witchcraft. Sharanya writes a regular feminist column called The Venus Flytrap in the New Indian Express, a major Indian newspaper. She's currently working on her next novel, titled Constellation of Scars, among other poetry, fiction, and illustration projects. I had the opportunity to meet and connect with Sharanya at a poetry reading in Chennai a few years ago, and when her book came out last year, I attended her reading and we got to discuss her work for Apex Express earlier this week by Skype. Listen up. So welcome to Apex Express, Sharanya Manivannan.
Thank you so much for having me, Preeti. It's a pleasure.
Great. I was so excited to attend your book reading back in Chennai a few months ago, and to have such a feminist work be read, discussed, blew me away, literally. I feel like on the one hand, things have come a far way in many ways in South Asian society, where we've begun to have complex conversations around love, desire, sex, and sexuality that your book kind of really opens the door for. So tell us about how you came to write this book. Now, this is your first work in fiction as a poet.
Yeah.
So tell us about the journey that led to this book.
Thank you, Preeti. One of the beautiful things about the response that the book has had so far is that people are acknowledging that it is a feminist work, which is what I always believed as I wrote it and as I lived the experiences that led to writing it. But at the same time, because it essentially subverts the romance genre, and talks about heteroromantic desire and relationships, there was always a danger that, it wasn't going to pass the Bechdel test, pretty much. So it's been delightful that people have seen the feminism in the book, whether it's subtle to them or overt. My journey in terms of writing this book certainly came from a personal place. It came from being a certain kind of woman in a certain kind of society, time, and place. By which I mean being in my 20s in a city like Chennai at this point in time, and how difficult that was and continues to be, in fact. And one of the areas in which I faced the greatest difficulty was in the department of love and romance. I found that, the arranged marriage, especially in its modern permutations, which are really not that progressive at all, is the dominant paradigm. And that there's really very, very little space for love, for growth, for partnership in a society in which sexuality is maligned. And so I began writing these stories by, you know, with a single question, which was, is it possible for a woman like me to have both love and freedom? And eventually, I found that the way to answer that question was to ask another one, which is, what if the answer is no? What do you then do? How do you then pursue love in a different form than what is allowed? And how do you define freedom? So that's really you know, what my journey was as a person and as a writer. Right. And that's how the book grew as well.
Great. And can you unpack a little bit for our listeners what it means to live as a single woman in her, you know, 20s in a city like Chennai? For those of mm-hmm. us who don't know, I mean, I also had a similar journey to you, but I also kept leaving the city because it was, I found it so oppressive. And I really admire somebody like you who has reluctantly but also bravely made it home and negotiating these, right? Which is also went into the book. So can you tell us a little bit more about what makes it a very hard city to grow up in, as much as I also love it, but it's also a very difficult city, as you talk about.
I'm 32 this year, and it will be 10 years since I moved to Madras, to Chennai. And I didn't grow up here, which automatically put me at a disadvantage, because this is very much a city of cliques. You had your school clique, your college clique, your caste clique, your church clique. You know, it's just, it's a very, very clannish place in that way. So I have always been an outsider, and I don't really see that changing, you know, especially 10 years into it. I remain quite firmly located as an outsider. But being, you know, spending my 20s here, it, you know, oppressive is certainly the right word. It's oppressive on so very many levels. It's a deeply patriarchal and misogynistic society. And this manifests in every possible way, from the smallest thing, from the fact that, you know, one almost always carries a shawl when you go outside, because you're constantly covering your breasts. You're constantly covering your arms. You just, it's expected of you, if not demanded.
Right.
To, you know, the party scene, for instance, you can't negotiate it really unless you are in the company of men and play by their rules. And it's, you know, it's just endless rules, spoken and unspoken codes, many of which I have not even cracked, but I have somehow managed to transgress. But beyond my personal experience, let me say that I've been fortunate in that I've never married. And at 31 years old, I am an anomaly in this society, a young woman who has never married. And what that means is that most of the women I know, or even the women I don't know, are usually married by their mid-20s. They either have arranged marriages, or they have a version of an arranged marriage where, you know, they're introduced to people who are already vetted and conform to certain criteria and sort of perform, you know, a romance of sorts, while, you know, actually, truthfully, they're already engaged. Or they get married, but they get married because that's the, really the only way to have sex. You know, unless you're constantly hiding and bribing cops and being afraid of being caught, and you know, you can't go to the gynecologist without being judged. There's just a million ways in which one is oppressed, as a woman in the city.
Absolutely. I remember when you typically go to a gynecologist, the first question they ask you is, you know, how long have you been married? And the assumption being that you can be only sexually active as a woman if you are married.
Correct.
Which is very problematic.
I mean, they don't ask if you're sexually active. They say, are you married or not? Mm-hmm. And then if you say no and you look the doctor in the eye, then she will clear her throat mm-hmm. and then ask you more directly. when in fact that's the only question that needs to be asked all along. You can be married and not at all sexually active.
Exactly. Which also I'm sure is, happens a lot. So, and then, you know, arranged marriage by now, even in American society, is a fairly, you know, accepted idea. And there's also a romanticized view of it here. Because it's seen as, oh, it's so convenient, why not? And even among, in progressive circles, I've encountered that approach to it, which is not necessarily a bad thing, but it also kind of, you know, sweeps under the carpet a whole bunch of issues that, you know, arranged marriage as an institution kind of, you know, glosses over, from all that you said about women's desires and sexuality to a certain way of doing things, right? And I think that's what you get at in your own analysis, that I think by now films that kind of, you know, both South Asian films and other films that kind of look at in the diaspora kind of have a romanticized view of arranged marriage as, oh, you know, in this day and age of online dating, arranged marriage is actually not a bad thing. It's more of an emerging and a dominant view that I've heard. So what is your response to that?
Well, the institution of marriage as it exists in India exists for one reason, and that's caste endogamy. You know, elsewhere in the world, the institution exists because of property, because of inheritance, because of land ownership. It's very much a financial kind of transaction. In this country, caste is the driving force behind the institution. So I'm very suspicious of people in the diaspora, as well as people in the subcontinent, who romanticize something which was never romantic in the first place. That being said, I do understand a sense of personal disillusionment, which can lead a person into accepting this because it's the easier way. And I think that brings with it a whole other set of problems and questions. Among them, how feminism is really misunderstood in India. And many people who say they're not feminists actually are, and many people who say they are feminists actually really aren't. And I think marriage is actually at the crux of all of this, because what keeps the continuity of the, you know, the Brahminical heteropatriarchal paradigm other than marriage?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So before we continue discussing your book, and would you like to read a small excerpt from it before we discuss?
Sure. So this vignette that I'm going to read opens the book and in many ways sets the tone for what is to come. It's called Self-Portrait Without Mythology. That's the thing about this business. Some days you sparkle like a teenage vampire. Some days you feel as though you walked through the remains of an exploded drishti posnika, which is to say, fucked. Most days, however, you pick out one item from your collection of lungis appropriated from men you have slept with, pin your hair up, cook your own lunch, and try not to think about it. Now and then you buy yourself a single red African daisy from a flower seller on the street. Sometimes you put it behind your ear. Sometimes you just keep it someplace where you can look at it. You count on very little to run like clockwork, except perhaps the power cuts. Time exists only if you stop to ponder it, and it's rarely wise to do this. It seems you were always here, long before you even arrived. Orbiting, pivoting on a constant, you can go for months without entering the sea, but there is no given moment when you cannot point out its precise cardinal direction. All of it is deep within your being, if not your body itself. Sweetness, slow dancing, the knowledge that grief has no after, places of pilgrimage, exigencies, seasons of plenitude, red light districts, the memory of mountains. Some things are important to you. These you must count frequently. there must be music. There must be something to drink. You love the sound of the human voice. And as difficult as you are, there are a few people for whom there will always be places at your table. You number among what you own a gramophone, a small seated bronze parvati, solitary, her left foot extended, her inguina open, and your grandmother's thali. You number among that which you share your life with, but do not possess. Windowsill cacti, visiting omens, other people's children, full and eclipsed moons, books, the company of trees, owls. There are no good photographs of you laughing from when your teeth were so crooked, but in your old age, you hope to be wild-eyed, white-haired, a fearsome and fabulous crone. You think of old age often. On the most recondite of days, the future shows itself to you in the blink of an eye. You are already there. You have always been here. You are superstitious about the handling of knives, barrels, and palidusha. You have few rules for this particular life that has become yours. But each is a consequence. Be observant but not vigilant, for the time for terror has passed. Love anyway. Praise every landscape that appears before your window. Hold in equal measure the beauty of a cyclone and the miracle of a single woodpecker on a swaying coconut tree. Bear witness. Nothing lasts forever and nothing is lost. Avoid regret. Love any way.
Wow. I love your lyrical poetic style that flows, you know, and then you structure it through your, you know, short story format in this book. So tell us about a little bit about High Priestess. Tell us a little bit about the stories and also, you know, in a very, I think, poetic and subtle way, you know, you laid out some of the key issues you want to talk about. Women's bodies and desires and sexuality is something so taboo, and even talking about it is seen as a frivolous or not an important issue, whereas it's at the heart of everything. And, you know, as myself, as somebody who has done anti-violence work and domestic violence work in the diaspora in the US, it's such a key issue that is never ever given its importance. And it's and from a proactive way, it's always seen in the time of, you know, when you're looking at it from a context of violence and harassment and abuse, and to look at it from a point of, you know, healthy sexuality and a woman owning her body and space and desire. Yeah. So tell us about that journey and that, and how you came to, you know, explore these themes in your book.
It was all really very intuitive. I didn't have this political framework for the book, but I began. It began on a much more lighthearted kind of note, which was that I found myself having all these odd adventures as this outsider in the city. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I write, that's just what I do. And that's how I express myself. That's how I make sense of things. So that's how I began this book. And gradually, as I went along, and especially in my mid to late 20s, when everything became much heavier and darker, and I began to have to carve a real sense of sovereign selfhood, which was a slant to this society, you know, and that entailed the creation of a kind of inner fortress. And so I started to write about that. I started to write about solitude. I started to write about strength. It was no longer just about love and sex and the misadventures and adventures that came with it. So the politics, I think, were, you know, even though it was instinctive, it grew with me so that by the time I finished writing the book, I was able to provide this kind of framework, this kind of scaffolding.
Was a track titled Kattu Siddiqui, a song featured in a popular Tamil film called Ravanan and was composed by noted music director A.R. Rahman. You're listening to KPFA 94.1 FM and you're tuned in to Apex Express. On tonight's South Asia Spotlight, we bring you part two of our discussion with poet and author Sharanya Manivannan, who's based in Chennai, India. And your book has, you have traveled a little bit with the book, right? And India is right now plush with a lot of literary festivals, big and small. And the last 10 or 15 years or so, there's been a great cross-pollination of ideas and young writers, writers like you emerging and having a space. Mm-hmm. Do you think it's changing? I mean, one of my own fears as somebody who spends a little chunk of time in India every year is that mm-hmm. sometimes when the more things change, the more they stay the same. But I do also want to hope that things have changed for the better, both for women and for society at large. And what has been your experience also discussing this book in other spaces and basically just observing life there?
You know, to be honest, I've not traveled very much with the book, just a little bit. But the book has traveled far beyond my own journeys. So it's been really wonderful hearing from women, most especially, some men as well, but mostly women from all kinds of places, from Kenya, from Australia, from Sri Lanka, from parts of India, which I not only never visited, but hadn't even dreamt of visiting, you know, like Sikkim and, right. You know, other places which I certainly haven't been and may never even get to go. I've heard from so many women, and I'm so glad that they see themselves reflected, because I see myself as a very lone kind of person, sometimes lonely, but always alone, in a kind of isolation. And, you know, to have this book resonate so much with other people was truly a surprise. And that tells me, you know, that I think that's something I can be hopeful about in terms of what that means for women at large in the society. But at the same time, I think there's a real risk in assuming that our small pockets of exposure, as well as our small spheres of influence, can really speak to or speak on behalf of anyone else. So I think there's a danger in me thinking, you know, I wrote this book and women like me have read this book and responded to it. That doesn't necessarily change things. I think the real work entails so much more conversation, so much more footwork, so much more pain, actually. In a lot of ways.
Yeah, absolutely. You had talked earlier about how, you know, a lot of women who don't identify as feminists are actually very mm-hmm. much so, and vice versa. Can you speak to that dichotomy and then also, you know, walking into your reading, for me to have somebody like you claim feminism and also really be feminist in your work very intentionally and thoughtfully was very refreshing. Mm. So can you speak to those dichotomies that you've also come across?
Absolutely. On the one hand, I think, you know, activism has become a kind of capitalist statement. It's also become a kind of commodity. And you can see that in a lot of advertising and media and even certain kinds of films. So there's a kind of sexy branding to a very, very superficial type of feminism, which is lacking in context, in history, and above all else, in compassion. So there are many people who embrace that kind of superficial feminism, but there's no follow through to that. And sometimes you wind up doing more damage to other people and to yourself as a result. On the other hand, there are many who, seeing this kind of superficiality, are turned off, mm-hmm. and don't realize that actually by their own pursuit of equality and ethics and integrity, they are properly leading rather feminist lives and certainly subscribe to feminist principles. So there is certainly a dichotomy, as you put it. Feminist branding, feminism's public image is quite deplorable, I would say, in India. It's very clickbait friendly, you know. Mm-hmm. It's the easiest kind of statement-making, attention-seeking type of thing, whereas the actual lived practice is very difficult and very demanding and involves a lot of compromise and a lot of sacrifice. It means that you don't give in, for instance, to an unequal partnership. You don't give in to a marriage which will secure your financial your financial security, because the compromise is your own freedom. These are things which every person has to deal with in her own life and make those choices. But there is something disingenuous about making choices which support and uphold the existing patriarchal paradigm while claiming feminism.
Mm-hmm. Right. I also, you've said many insightful things in our discussion so far. And one of those is also about the caste aspect. I really want to, thank you for that, because even in the diaspora, when we talk about caste, it's extremely difficult, especially in a Hindu-dominated upper caste diaspora that dominates the narrative. It's so clear that, maintaining caste hierarchies and caste lines then becomes even more crucial, here as a way to kind of and invoking culture and all that, right? So I think, and then again, once again, that is once again so oppressive, because it's always done on women's bodies and it's very patriarchal. So so it is hard to break free, because I think they're finding new and newer ways of reestablishing the old code, therefore doesn't really go away, it just reconfigures, I think. And that's very sad,
that's disturbing. Right.
That's why I feel like, the more things change, they actually are remaining the same in different ways, like sort of like an old wine and a new bottle, which is why, then how do we liberate, right? Like, what does liberation look like, and what does freedom look like? And which is why I think your book is a very refreshing peek into that. So do you want to maybe tell a little bit about some of the stories and maybe share a favorite story from the book?
I'd love to do that. So the story is kind of, the format I've used is odd. There is a mix of vignettes and short stories of a standard length and a couple of novelettes. And I must give credit to the book Woman Hollering Creek by Sandra Cisneros. I must have read it about 15 years ago, and it had a real lasting impact on my work, because firstly, she uses that kind of strange format, and she also uses Spanish and Spanglish so easily.
Right.
And similarly, in my book, I use that kind of strange, odd mixture of lengths. And I use patois, I use Tanglish, I use Tamil. There are no italics, there's no glossary. The words aren't translated, because I truly believe in translingualism. I truly believe that what is meant to be communicated, meant to be conveyed, will be communicated and conveyed. And I don't see the point of changing my language in order to make it more palatable, because we've all got Google,
Yes.
You know, so that's the format of the book. My favorite story, I think, is one called Conchology, which took me many years to complete writing. And it's got several different entwined threads. There's the legend of the Fisher King from the, you know, from the Arthurian stories, who, you know, the keeper of the grail, who is wounded and sits by a lake. There's Oppari, which is, you know, women's mourning, the songs that are used in women's mourning. There's a mermaid in the Batiklo Lagoon, and Batiklo is my maternal hometown in Sri Lanka. There's a woman, a photographer, who, you know, finds herself befriending an Oppari singer, but she's also got this remarkably privileged life because she goes off to Paris and she thinks of her friend, the fisherwoman, you know, as she's crossing the bridges of Paris. And all of this is kind of intertwined in a way that took me a very long time to get just right. You know, the mermaid mythology, the Tamil folklore, the Tamil folk songs, the you know, the Arthurian legend, the Parisian stuff. But that is my favorite story. And I just hope that people pick up the book and read it. Aside from that, there are many stories which are set here in Madras. Friendship is a very important theme, because part of building alone is building those relationships which are not substitutes for the so-called real thing. Many people make this mistake of, you know, forsaking their friendships because they find romantic partnership.
Right.
And that's something which my characters don't really do, and which I don't do either. But I learned that over time. Another story which I really care about is Sweetness, Wildness, Greed, in which a woman treks into the Nilgiris with a group of honey gatherers, traditional honey gatherers, and watches them as they perform this expedition. And that's a journey that I made myself. Very similar to the character in the book, because I felt I had to see this for myself. The story Afternoon Sex is quite close to my heart because it's a 10,000 word story, and it represented a huge learning curve for me as a writer. That was the most ambitious thing I had completed when I, you know, when I wrote it 6-7 years back. And you know, that has a woman who is in a marriage that she believes is happy and which she believes has saved her life, but she continues an affair with an old boyfriend of hers, and that's the thing that really gives her life meaning and worth and passion. And she tries to hold on to both of these things for as long as she can. Each of the stories has been close to my heart at different points. So I could go on and on. I think there are 26 stories in all. So I should stop.
Yeah, and they're a delightful read. And I have to say that it looks like you've spent a lot of time doing research for, you know, for a number of years. So cumulatively, have you spent about, 10 years on this, getting this book?
No, it was about 5 or 6 years.
Okay.
But I love research. Research to me is what editing is to most other writers, because many writers tell me that the real writing for them happens in the course of editing. For me, the real writing happens in the course of reading. I love research. I love, you know, not just reading as much as I can, but attending performances, having experiences, pursuing knowledge before I settle down and tell my story. You know, for instance, one of my forthcoming project that I'm working on. The other day, I was reading an obscure French libretto using Google Translate. And this is my idea of fun. You know, I really love awesome. Doing this stuff. I really love knowledge gathering.
Which, you know, in this day and age of big data and Google and everything on the cloud is still a lot of, you know, it's not easy. I mean, it's also making sense of information, right? And so you were saying that you're working on a next novel or a book?
Well, I am working on a novel. I'm also working on a graphic novel, which is kind of related to The High Priestess Never Marries, because the mermaid I mentioned earlier, mm-hmm. that's who this graphic novel is about. So I'll give you the backdrop to it. And I don't think I've ever talked about this publicly, Preeti. So thanks for getting it out of me. I'm really excited about this. So my mother's hometown, as I said, is Batiklo in the east of Sri Lanka. And there is a lagoon there. And on full moon night, if you go into the lagoon and you stick the oar into the water and hold the other end to your ear, you can hear this mysterious sound. And they, you know, in the old days, they would say it's the Jean Mahal, the mermaid, who are singing. In the 60s, there were American missionaries who went into the lagoon and conducted research and determined that the sound was coming from a kind of conish shell. Now, this is where my story begins. There is almost no existing folklore about this mermaid. She is the emblem of Batiklo town. You know, they call her the singing fish now. If you visit the town, she's on menus, she's on an arch as you enter the town. There are mermaids everywhere. But how can there not be stories? So I see this as a part of the initial that happened over 3 decades of civil war, in which so many stories and so many other narratives were lost. And that's what I'm pursuing in my research now. And I'm working on a graphic novel about this elision, as well as whatever I can reconstruct about this mysterious mermaid.
Sounds amazing. Well, as we wrap up, do you have any closing thoughts? Can you also tell our listeners how they can buy your book online?
Absolutely. If you're in the US or anywhere outside of India, Amazon.com has both hardcover as well as Kindle editions. I would recommend getting the hardcover because it's a beautifully produced book. It's really nice to hold, and the texture of the cover is lovely. And these are things I just have to thank my publisher for. That's not me at all. I can only hope that you find the contents as beautiful. It's also available on Kindle. Yes, Amazon is a good place to pick up the book anywhere in the world.
Great. I own both, so I'm very happy that I have the hard copy, I have to say. So any closing thoughts, Sharanya?
No, it's been such a pleasure talking to you, Preeti. I've really enjoyed it. Thank you so much for your support and your solidarity. That really means a lot.
That was a discussion I had recently with poet and author Sharanya Manivannan on her first work of fiction, The High Priestess Never Marries, published last year and available on Amazon and online bookstores. You can follow Sharanya's work online at sharanyamanivannan.wordpress.com. That's sharanyamanivannan. Next up is a segment by Apex contributor Melissa Hung about Chinatown, art, food, and gentrification. Listen up.
It's a sunny day in San Francisco. In Chinatown, pedestrians make their way on the streets. In Portsmouth Square Plaza, seniors crowd around makeshift tables, engaged in games. Nearby, a trio of musicians play together. Just 2 blocks away, the scene is quieter in one of Chinatown's many alleys. But foot traffic is still steady. Pedestrians walk past one storefront, an art gallery. So tell me about the space that we're in.
So we're in 41 Ross. It's a pop-up art gallery and community space that the Chinatown Community Development Center and the Chinese Culture Center run together. And it's a community space, it's a space for exhibits, it's a space for programs, and really it's an opportunity for local residents as well as visitors to learn more about the community and have an art space that's within their community that they can go to for free.
That's Erica G. She's a senior planner for the Chinatown Community Development Center, or Chinatown CDC for short. 41 Ross is both the name of the gallery and its address. It officially opened in July 2015. Hanging on its walls now are large photographs of food from Chinatown restaurants and portraits of the people who make the food. The photos are part of an exhibit called Eat Chinatown. Erica is here with her colleague Roy Chan, a community planning manager from Chinatown CDC. They're here to tell me why Chinatown needs a community gallery.
I think first off, a lot of the arts and culture institutions, they don't always locate right in the heart of where people walk. And so I think Ross Alley is really interesting being located here. We're in the oldest alley in Chinatown, if not the city. It's probably the most frequented alley for pretty much every slice of the demographics here, both residents, visitors, tour groups, all sorts of folks. Literally thousands of people walk by here. And, you know, walking through Ross is like walking through the history of Chinatown. I mean, you get a taste of everything from the SRO units above to the flower shops that have been here for a while to the Golden Gate Fortune Cookie Factory to just a sense of timelessness about this alley. And so being here is quite magical, actually, for us.
For Chinatown Eats, Chinatown CDC worked with photographer Andrea Lowe and writer Valerie Liu. The artists focused on legacy businesses that have been in the neighborhood for more than 30 years. They're small mom-and-pop places, not new trendy additions to the neighborhood. Capital Restaurant, Han's Wonton House, Eastern Bakery, and New Lung Tin Cafe, also known as Pork Chop House, are the eateries featured in the show. An additional 6 businesses are featured on a website run by Chinatown CDC called Spotlight Chinatown. The show celebrates these eateries and the memory of popular restaurants now gone. But it is also a way to market these businesses. In San Francisco, the construction of the Central Subway, which will end with a station in Chinatown, has reduced revenue for businesses along its route. Here's Andrea Lowe, the photographer.
For some of the projects, they would have us focus specifically on telling stories from businesses that are closest to the construction. But in general, we're looking to bring more people to Chinatown, letting them know that the neighborhood is alive and well and still as vibrant as ever. And they also were interested in, I think, in a way, outreaching to younger generation, because a lot of people who go to Chinatown either live there and are seniors or maybe just work nearby in the financial district.
Erica G says her organization is keeping an eye on the subway and what it might mean for the character of the neighborhood.
One of the concerns is if these businesses can survive, you know, the construction, where they might see declines in their businesses, and then what is it going to look like after the subway is open? You know, are there going to be commercial rents and new businesses that come in because there might be new people who are living around the area or new as the terminus of the subway? Are new people going to come in and want different kinds of things in Chinatown and willing to pay, you know, higher rents?
Chinatowns originally formed at the edges of downtowns. As commercial and residential areas expanded, they held on. Today, Chinatowns are located in downtowns. San Francisco's is the oldest, formed when the first wave of Chinese immigration began in the 1850s. Today, it still serves as a place for new immigrants to live and work.
It's an immigrant gateway, and it's sort of a launching pad for many new immigrants that don't have a lot, but they need a place to start their lives. And so, for instance, SRO, single-room occupancy units, are these, you know, 120 feet, rooms that make up these SROs, many families live in these spaces. And for the longest time, they were sort of housing for the last resort. And now we're seeing SRO rents skyrocket to over $1,000 and being marketed to tech workers and students. And so it's starting to price out the immigrants who we serve. Similarly, you know, commercial spaces are starting to feel the pressures of higher rents. And so it's harder for them to compete. And so with the Central Subway Station coming in, it really kind of creates sort of that transit-oriented development effect in a lot, that we see in a lot of neighborhoods that accelerates gentrification. It increases rents. It becomes a very attractive place for people that want to live in the city, be able to take transit, be able to work in their office and not have to go too far. And so all of a sudden, being where we're at in Chinatown, once again, we're faced with this challenge of a lot of forces coming our way and threaten the identity of Chinatown being an immigrant gateway.
While the art exhibits in the gallery space don't confront gentrification directly, they do celebrate the spirit of immigrant survival and tell stories of the neighborhood's residents. In the process of researching for Eat Chinatown, the artists uncovered a history of Chinatown through its food. Here's Valerie Liu.
We knew we had to interview 10 restaurants, and from there we were trying to figure out an angle. And one reoccurring theme we came across was, like, why are there these Chinese restaurants that also serve American food and kind of have a diner aesthetic? And what we found out was that a lot of these places were bachelor cafes, and they were a place for single men or men to eat, like, a full meal on their own. Due to things like the Chinese Immigration Act, this kind of limited immigration, a lot of men who came here to work couldn't bring their families or their wives over, so they were kind of just this bachelor society. And places like Porkchop House had bar seating where single men kind of, you know, eat by themselves, get a full meal on one dish rather than eating family style, which is typical of Chinese cuisine. And so there's this bit of history that kind of affected the food in Chinatown, and that we tried to bring to light. And it's relevant now with, you know, immigration bans, talk of a Muslim ban. It's kind of history almost repeating itself. So that's one of the points we try to bring up in the show, is that it's happened before.
It's midday, between the lunch and dinner rushes at Capital Restaurant. The staff members are sitting down to their family meal. When Chinatown CDC first approached Capital's owner, Samantha Low, about participating in the exhibit, she agreed right away. Not everyone did. Some said they were too busy. Others reacted with suspicion. But Samantha is thrilled. She worked her way up from waitress to owner of this restaurant. Her portrait is featured in the show. Did you go see the Eat Chinatown exhibit?
Yeah, I did. They do a very good job. I'm so happy to that. They take, like, the photo is beautiful for, you know, recommend for other people. And sometimes we want the restaurant ourselves, then we sell them to go visit the other. And then some history we didn't know, we just do ourselves, right? So, and this chance to get us to know each other.
For Apex Express, I'm Melissa Hung.
That was Melissa Hung reporting on the Chinatown Eats exhibit in San Francisco's Chinatown. The exhibit will be up through April 16th at 41 Ross. The gallery is open Thursday to Sunday, 11 a.m. to 4 p.m. Visit spotlightchinatown.org to see photos from the exhibit and learn about some of the featured restaurants. Roundup of community events before we wrap up. San Francisco Women Against Rape is holding its 12th annual Walk Against Rape this Saturday, April 8th in San Francisco. For registration and details, visit sfwar.org/walk and join the movement to end sexual violence. Also on is the San Francisco International Film Festival that kick-started yesterday in the city. Do check out their packed schedule online, and a plug-in for the tribute event with noted Bollywood actor Shah Rukh Khan, who will be speaking about his work. That's on Friday, April 14th. For more information about this event and the film schedule, please visit sffilm.org/festival. And that brings us to an end to tonight's show. I've been your host and producer, Preeti Mangla Shekhar. Do join Apex Express's online community on Facebook and follow our WordPress blog. Email us show ideas and feedback at apex@kpfa.org. Tune back in next week for another edition of Apex Express. A big thank you to Mike Biggs, our faithful board op. Our theme music is by Asian Crisis.